Pretty much welcome to the lecture on action and cognition. I suggest we start because it's full anyway, so waiting for even more is not that good. I'm very happy that you are here. So first question would be, many of you were already here at 6 o'clock sharp. We can of course start a little bit earlier, let's say 5 past the hour or so, or is it rushing you coming from downtown or so? You have any preferences, starting 6:15 or 6:05? Quarter past? Okay, we stick with 6:15, that's just perfect. Then I would like to make a little advertisement. This lecture is videotaped, so that you can look in StudIP, the lecture notes, as well as what we are discussing here. These are the cameras, and the microphone is very important to make the videotaping worthwhile. So if you watch me here starting to talk without the microphone, please remind me to put on the microphone. It's good for the stuff. Today we will spend quite some time on the formal stuff, giving a little bit overview of what's up in the winter term. And the second half I will start with the contents of the lecture. In the middle, we have a little break with a small video, and then I talk a little bit about the big picture of the brain, divisions, cortical areas, and so on. And we stop with the questions. So, formal stuff. Contact. Best is email. Of course, I'm happy to talk with you and discuss with you before the lecture or after the lecture, but please don't build on that I recall in the evening what you have told me, or who you are, or that I wrote down your email address. Putting a little note per email to me is always a good idea. It's sitting in the inbox till I do something about it. Next is Tim Kietzmann will give a few of these lectures here during the term. He did this once during the summer term, and I'm pretty sure it will be top quality. So don't be surprised if he shows up in the coming weeks once in a while to give the lecture. For more information what we are doing in general, you might have a look at the neurobiology website. Time and place, as we just discussed, 6:15, we are starting here in this lecture hall. The language is English. But of course, if you feel more comfortable asking a question in German, no problem with that. Or just speak up. Big point, StudIP, please do register on StudIP. Because in the end, when it's about certificates, I take the list of enrollments in StudIP. And if your name is missing there, you have a fair chance that you don't get your certificate. Next is, if something is, has to be changed with organization, I use the email list of StudIP. So please register here. It's helping everybody. You get 4 ECTS points. And the what you have to do is, you have to show up on the day of the exam, and you have to write a beautiful exam. That's what's really important for the lecture. So that you are sitting here, I do hope it's helpful to reach that goal, definitely, but we don't do control of attendance or whatsoever. This is very different in the seminar. In the seminar, it's about being here, discussing, and the scientific exchange. In the lecture, it's only important that you do a great exam. The lecture and seminar will be synchronized. So if you're attending the seminar, it's a very, very good idea to attend the lecture. However, it's not a formal requirement. It's up to you. If for some strange reason you select only the seminar and you skip the lecture to cope with the contents, if you do the lecture and you skip the seminar, no problem at all. The lecture is self-contained. You can be happy with attending just the lecture and not doing the seminar. Okay, to get you successful on the way to exam, Ulrike Kuhl, Basil Wahn, and Matti Krüger are the tutors for the action cognition, and the tutorials will be, Matti, is Thursday 2 to 4, is that correct? Wonderful. Okay, we'll be on Wednesday, Thursday and Friday 2 to 4. The three of us, or I see Basil and Matti sitting there in the back. The purpose of the tutorials is to exercise and to rehearse the contents of the lecture. Because I think understanding is an active process, and I will pose a set of questions always at the end of the lecture, between 5 and 10, and essentially the exam is composed of these questions. Maybe one is slightly modified, updated or so, but if you can cope with these questions, you will be very happy at the exam. And of course, the questions relate to the big points of the lecture. If you can answer them, you have understood and you can cope well with the lecture. And so far, I highly recommend attending these tutorials. It will deepen your understanding and will get you to a successful exam. And they have done a great job in the summer term. They have actually helped me a lot with composing the questions, refining the questions, streamlining the stuff, making materials for you to learn. So it's really a worthwhile effort. Next is, I would like to make an advertisement of another, well, there are really a lot of cool lectures and seminars here, but the Math Lab in Cognitive Science, it's given by Andrei Melnik, and the tutor is Benedikt Ehinger, who is also standing there. Galileo Galilei has said, the book of nature is written in the mathematical language, and I'm afraid he's right. If you work in empirical sciences, there is just no way around getting to grasp with MATLAB or some equivalent programming language. And I know it's painful. It will take some part of your life. It's like learning a foreign language. You learn a few years, English, French, or whichever language you are speaking, and it will take, let's say, half a year, maybe more, a full year, to get a basic knowledge in these techniques. And it will come up to you at some point in your life, and I just recommend start now to get over with it. And if you write a bachelor thesis under my supervision, be sure we come back to that. And it's a very easy introduction. It's earlier, way back, we had it very closely parallel to the action cognition lecture. There are still relations to the action cognition lecture. Therefore, I advertise it here. So that the questions are framed somewhat in the context of the topics we discuss here. But of course, the focus is on learning these techniques. Next, for the action cognition to learn, we have up to now, we have the questions. Next is, for introduction of the lectures, I have collected a set of background papers. These are helpful to get you tuned into the topic. They are helpful for after the lecture reading in a closed set about the stuff. They are not one-to-one congruent to the contents of the lecture, but they are written by top scientists and are high-quality papers, and essentially they are just uploaded in StudIP. So for each week, you have one, in some cases you have two background papers, typically review papers by prominent figures in the field, and I highly recommend it. And yeah, this is here. Some are actually give insight into how science is working. You might have the impression that if you are going to be a scientist, you sit down, you think hard, you come up with a hypothesis, a brilliant idea, you think a little bit more, you devise an experiment to test it, and you falsify it or you support it. Sometimes it's that way, but more often than not, it's not. Here, Jubel and Wiesel, let's say these are Nobel laureates, and they have forged the field. They have done seminal work in the visual neurosciences. Their work has dominated the field for decades. It cannot be overemphasized, and it dominates a good part of the lecture as well. And essentially, they were young at some point, and our plans can have taken no more than 30 minutes to formulate that day in Hopkins Cafeteria. It's ridiculous. Half an hour on the way to the Nobel Prize. They sat down with a coffee and discussed and made a plan. Then to do it, of course, it was hard work. And they go on and say, okay, in some sense, they have been lucky. They have just worked in a lab which was just a wonderful atmosphere. And they go on even more. They detail the experiments. Well, they were very smart. Okay, but it was not the experiments itself which earned the Nobel Prize. It was that after 7 hours of work, something stupid happened. Old-fashioned technology, a slide, was getting oblique in the slide projector. And neurons responded more to that. And they got notice of it. They thought, hey, what's going on here? They not just corrected it. They wondered, okay, why is it happening? So it was actually an accident. It was not ingenious foresight that they planned. We do that experiment in that way. They did a sort of simple experiment, and it just happened, like with penicillin and the fungi on the petri dish you might have heard. So in some sense, they worked hard day and night, and just chance stroke. And this is life. And it happens more often than not. And in so far, these papers tell you also a little bit about great mind think, how their life happened, and take a little bit away the illusion that you can plan science in a literal way. I don't say that hard work is not important. To the contrary, hard work is very important. But on its own, it's not just a guarantee. And so far, this is also an aspect which is important in these background papers. Questions? Okay, you will see such slide at the end of each week's lecture. And we work a little bit on those questions I select in the start of the following week, one or two, and ask you. And I say, oh, those in the front rows are, of course, prone to be selected. But not everybody can sit at the back. So I discuss with you and suggest that you start giving an answer. And if you are attending the tutorials, it will be easy for you to do that. And I emphasize, time will come when you take the exam, you actually have to answer those questions. So make an effort to learn already now, each week after the lecture, the following day or so, rehearse the stuff a little bit. Don't delay it till end of January. It's too much contents. Don't wait. Start being, keep on the ball already now. Next is lecture notes against StudIP. I upload sometimes Sunday, Saturday, so when I do the polishing of the lecture, my lecture notes onto StudIP, the PDFs. So I have seen repeatedly some of you sit here with the laptops or with the printout of the PDFs in order to make notes, or you can download those PDFs just to rehearse, to think about it. We have a script. It's not uploaded yet, but I uploaded in StudIP as well. Sure, and it's by now a few years old. It's not completely congruent to the lecture anymore because I change a little bit each year, obviously, and over the years the changes are accumulating. But the script has been done by fellow students of yours a few years back, and it's great material. And it also addresses the big points, so in order to understand issues, it's a very, very good start. We have some students enthusiastic created a wiki page-based system. Have a look. If you like it, we can make more investments. Up to now, the success was sort of limited. I had the feeling you prefer stuff where you can start reading on page 1, and if you are down at the bottom of page 12, you have got some stuff. And with the wiki, you can look up little things, but it's hard to use it for consistent learning. But if you have a positive experience with it and you think it's worthwhile to develop and invest more, please do tell me. Then we have the video lecture. It's also on StudIP. There is a tab here, way to the right. It's only in those lectures which are videotaped. You can click on it, And the beautiful thing is, you have the video of, well, typically here, so I'm on it unless I go to the side. And very important, you have the slides here, so that it's synchronized to what I'm talking or what you are asking and so on. So if for some reason you miss a lecture, no harm done, you can look it here. Evaluations, okay, we can discuss towards the end of the lecture. Sometimes there are evaluations of the University of Osnabrück. There are public sites like My Professor, where you are very much welcome to give statements or ratings, and I actually do look at that stuff. So once in a term or once in a year, I read all the evaluations and think about what can be improved and so on. Questions from your side? Yes, please. I don't know yet. It won't be here. This can be communicated via a news feed on StudIP, because you can enroll in the tutorials. And I suggest when the rooms, so the request has been filed for the rooms, and once it's clear, we mail it via the StudIP system. More questions? Okay. Prerequisites. So in principle, you should have heard Foundations of Neurobiology and Functional Neuroanatomy. And not? Sensory Physiology, sorry. Sensory Physiology, yes. So I've assembled a few slides of course, there you learned a lot of important stuff. I just assembled a few slides, what's crucial here to rehearse it and to spend 10 minutes on these fundamentals. That's a cartoon of a few neurons. You see the zoma of the neuron with the cell body, with all the genetic information and all the organelles. And specific for neurons are all these extensions. And all extensions you see are dendrites, all but one, which is termed the axon. Now, something special is about neurons. They do have a resting membrane potential as all other cells as well, which means this is a blow up of the bilipid layer, which forms the hull of the neuron or other cells, and it's differentially selective for positive and negative ions. And it's the differential conductivity is set up in a way that you have an outflow of positive ions, but the negative ions cannot get out. So negative charge accumulates, and you have a negative polarization of the interior of the cell body compared to the exterior. Now, the special thing about neurons is they have a special type of channel, a voltage-dependent sodium channel, which means if for some reason you have a change of the resting membrane potential towards zero, so depolarization, those channels do open, and they are conductive for positive ions, which flow in from the outside because they are missing inside, specifically sodium ions flow in and enhance the depolarization, can actually reverse it, have a positive charge of the zoma, which is going very rapidly. And because it's a threshold process, the process itself is not dependent on the history of the whole stuff. But once the threshold is reached and the cascade is starting, you have a unitary event. You have a rush in of the sodium ions up to a peak, and then the channels close, they desensitize, some stuff is happening, potassium ions are flowing out, and everything is reset to balance. And this event is called an action potential. It's a unitary event. If it's happening, it's always happening in the same way. And importantly, this event can spatially propagate along the axon. If it's reaching the end of the axon, it's reaching a synapse. There, a special event is taking place that the action potential leads to an inflow and to a release of calcium, which leads to a fusion of vesicles, which are loaded with transmitter with the cell membrane. The transmitter are expelled in the intercellular space, reach the postsynaptic neuron, and change different stuff there. They react with receptors, and depending on the type of receptor and channels or second messenger cascades, they can influence the potential of the postsynaptic neuron. So, if you go home and your parents ask you, okay, now, what have you learned? How does the brain work? If you tell that story, yes, that's the way the brain works. That's the way it is. And what I will tell you during the upcoming term is just a refinement of that. The brain has very many of these neurons, 10 billion, so these are Milliarden, nicht Billionen in German, so it's the American billion. And each neuron has roughly a few thousand of these synapses, and this whole network is exchanging all these little impulses, and something is happening. Among others, perception is happening, which is a big mystery, and we will discuss that at length. Of course, there are many interesting details. For example, different transmitters have different effects, and not all neurons are created equal. But these are, let's say, second-order details. The major effects are as shown here. Now, you might ask, okay, what about vision? We are all looking around in the world, have this colorful impression, and here I'm talking about action potentials. So, let's look how it's happening here. This is a cross-section through the eye. Here you have the cornea. Here's the iris, which gives a colorful color to the eye. So, if you say somebody has blue eyes or brown eyes or green eyes, it's the color of that segment. Here you have the lens, which is changing its curvature depending on your accommodation, whether you read something close or far away. This is the vitreous body, which is transparent. And down here, the thin sheet is the retina. So the light enters from here, is focused onto the retina, and I might say the optical properties of the eyes are very well understood. We do know how it's working, and for example, if you have something wrong with the cornea, that you need an artificial lens or glasses and so on. Here is a blow-up of the retina, and you see here the rods and cones, which are aligned, strangely, on the outside of the eye. And there are different types of cells, specifically bipolar cells, horizontal cells, amacrine cells, connecting the ganglion cells. Now, when light enters the eye, the image of the visual world is focused onto the retina. The photons are hitting the rods and cones, and via a chemical cascade, an electric event is generated. The electric event does propagate via the bipolar cells to the ganglion cells. And by all means, the ganglion cells are neurons of the brain. So they behave exactly like the neurons here. And already in a developmental sense, they are a part of the brain, although they are outside of the skull. And I might say so, there is nothing intrinsic visual about these ganglion cells. They exchange action potentials, as all the other neurons, and specifically, if you look, for example, into the cochlea, part of the inner ear, where sound waves are transformed to, via again a cascade, to action potentials in neurons, it's the same neurons, you won't be able to distinguish these, and the same type of action potentials relaying the information to more central structures. But I might emphasize, on one hand, this is an extremely smart scheme, because in the brain, all the different senses, seeing, hearing, smelling, tactile, and taste, are translated to the same language. The language is always the action potentials I discussed here, which is beautiful, because it makes so easy to integrate vision and audition, that you realize, okay, it's me who is talking here. And it's deepening the riddle, how do we have the specificity of perception, that you don't mix up vision and audition? Okay, we can discuss synesthesia, we do it at some point, and these are interesting problems, but As clever the scheme is that you have neurons communicating by action potentials as a universal language in the brain, actually, for me, it makes a big question mark how vision and audition and all the other stuff has its individual properties. We will follow vision to more central structures. Here you see the eye again, sort of part of what we have seen in the previous slide. It's projecting to the lateral geniculate nucleus here, where it's contacting other neurons, which project to primary visual cortex. Primary visual cortex, complex name, but in principle it's simple. It's part of the cerebral cortex, which you see here, the big stuff, and we will talk extensively about that one. Those neurons are reacting to visual input, and actually there are the neurons which get notice from the visual signals first. So therefore it's called primary visual cortex. For orientation, we will use a certain coordinate system. This is a lateral view, so you would view my head from the lateral side here. The visual cortex is located here in a dorsal view, so looking from here, you see it here, and the coordinate system is that anterior is here to the left, would be the forehead, posterior is here, medial is in the midline, lateral here, dorsal and ventral is actually here and here, which is sometimes confusing because during development the neural tube bends at a certain stage and the coordinate system bends with it. So in a more natural way, if you put your head way up, then dorsal would be on the back, therefore here, and ventral would be here. There is yet another axis, rostral to caudal, which is sort of bent and follows the neural tube, so gets the curve together with as a neural tube during development. So if you have a structure which is more rostral, it is so to say suggested that it's higher up, more developed, more sophisticated, more modern compared to more caudal structures, which are here the medulla oblongata going down to the spinal cord. Okay, what we are up to. In principle, we want to understand the mind. This is what I would like to do. Big problem. We divide it up a little bit. We have slightly smaller problems. Vision, attention, neglect, consciousness, language, decision, actions. These are still huge, obviously. But I guess this is why you are sitting here, what you want to know. As it happens, we cannot start talking vision in a data-free room. We have to get a little bit facts as well. So we will start talking about primary visual cortex, or V1 for visual one. We will work up our way to parietal cortex, to supplementary motor cortex. We will discuss spinal cord, basal ganglia, and so on. Furthermore, we will have to discuss methods. Extracellular recordings, local field potentials, correlation functions, EEG, MEG, fMRI, spectrograms. When you read a newspaper, and there will be flashing news like decisions have been found in, let's say, prefrontal cortex, then I instantly think, okay, let me think about it. How would they want to find out that stuff? Most probably, they have done an fMRI study with humans. But well, with fMRI, you do not see these little action potentials. What you see is the blood flow. And of course, when you are thinking and your neurons are active, this is consuming energy, it has its consequences for blood flow, but it's not one-to-one. And actually, by now we know that there's a dissociation between the fMRI signal and neuronal activity and perceptual life when it's getting interesting. So in order to evaluate such reports, it's also important to know about methods. And so far, I'm afraid in this lecture, will start talking a lot about this stuff and that stuff, and week by week we work our way up here to the questions, in order to get a little bit facts and data to have educated opinions and discussions here on these, on that stuff. And I hope to present a nice mixture, and this is a plan. We have an introduction, which is today. Next week we will talk about primary visual cortex. So let's say 10 years ago, which is not long, 80% of the papers where neuronal recordings would address primary visual cortex or closely associated structures like lateral geniculate nucleus or so. By now the situation is changing a little bit, but primary visual cortex is arguably the part of cerebral cortex we understand best. And so far, it's a good start. We work our way up, directly have a bifurcation to different pathways. We discuss gestalt loss and binding and attention, and we will work out how along the sequence an objective view is step by step replaced by a subjective view. So when we are discussing primary visual cortex, essentially I will communicate the view of representations. There is an objective world out there. It's generating photons and phonons and all that stuff, and it's further processed by my eye and by my retina, and primary visual cortex does its best to build up a veridical representation of the world. This will be roughly the story. And here we'll argue, well, the processing is not as veridical, as truthful as it should be or could be, but it's heavily influenced by your personal experience and what you learned. So you process what you are used to process, what you are used to see, not necessarily what is objectively out there. Next is gestalt and binding makes it more difficult even that your interpretation of the information has a very strong subjective bias. And with attention, you feel free to emphasize different aspects. With neglect, well, this is a clinical condition, but you, so to say, you ignore part of the information, and with imagery, you make it up all on your own. And actually, I will argue that imagery is not a strange phenomenon, which by some chance you can do, but actually it's a phenomenon which shows an inherent aspect of normal processing as such. That normal processing is not as bottom-up.